Joe Levine, one of the authors of our textbook, is quoted as saying, "Earth is a living planet on which all forms of life are linked to one another and to land, water, and air. Through these links, energy flows and matter cycles in patterns that support life, including human society. We know enough about these patterns to realize that they are changing, in part due to human activity, in ways we don't yet understand. Our challenge is to study our impact on the biosphere and plan for a healthy future." As we go through this unit, we'll be studying the relationships between living organisms and their environment and learning how we can plan for a healthy future. So, get your papers ready. Wide right, skinny left. See you on the next slide. In Earth's biosphere, populations of organisms, or biotic factors, not only react with one another, but also with the three major divisions of the abiotic environment. The lithosphere, or soil and rock, that you see here with the brown arrow. The atmosphere, which are the gases surrounding the Earth, which you see up there in the sky with the gray arrow. And the hydrosphere, which includes all of Earth's water, solid, liquid, gas, fresh, or saline, which is salty. You see that there in the blue arrow. So the biosphere includes populations of living organisms and all the abiotic environment. Okay, the lithosphere, or rock and soil, the atmosphere, the air, and the hydrosphere, or the water. Ecology is the study of these interactions. It's a term coined by Ernest Haeckel in the mid-1800s from the Greek word oikos, meaning house. He looked at the living world and thought that it was a household with an economy. Everything plays a role, and everything has a job. The biggest house is the biosphere. It contains all land, water, air, atmosphere, everything that supports life. And we're going to be studying the interactions that take place within this biosphere. In order to understand relationships, scientists often divide events and organisms up by their complexity, from simple to complex, from large group to single individual. Biology is no different. You will see this many, many times as we move through the year. Starting with our biosphere is divided up into biomes. A biome is a group of ecosystems with a similar climate and dominant communities. More on those in a minute. You probably studied biomes in elementary or middle school. An example of a biome, a specific land biome, might be the Atacama Desert or the coastal plains of Texas. Even marine biomes like the Mississippi River or the Caribbean or the Gulf of Mexico. Ecosystems are all the organisms in a particular place with their non-living environment as well. An example might be the forest floor or the forest canopy, the pond community here, a pond ecosystem, or a field ecosystem. So as we continue traveling through smaller and smaller groups, our next one is a community. So the ecosystem had all the organisms and their non-living environment. A community is made up of all the different populations of organisms that are assembled in a defined area. So in this ecosystem here, we have a community, and the community is all the living things. The wildebeests, the grasses, the shrubs, the lions, the mice, whatever's in there. So communities are made up of all different populations. A population consists of one group of individuals of the same species in the same area. So in this picture we have a population of wildebeests. We have a population of whatever kind of grass this is in the front. We have a population of, it looks like, at least a couple of different kinds of shrubs or small trees towards the background, and of course a population of lions. a population, and one thing to understand about population is a population of, say, deer in Bear Creek Park is different than a population of deer that may live, say, in Memorial Park, because they're in two different places. They may be the same kind of deer, but it's two different populations. They live in two different communities in two very different ecosystems. Now, that may all be in the same biome, but it still is two different ecosystems. Lastly, scientists may study individual organisms of a particular species. Remember, the definition of species is that it is an organism that can breed and produce fertile offspring. So you may see organisms like the donkey, which is in the top picture here, or the horse, which is in the bottom picture. Both of those are species because they can mate and reproduce and have fertile offspring. However, if we mate a donkey to a horse, we get a mule. A mule is not a recognized species because mules cannot reproduce normally. Every once in a while you'll get one that does, but normally they can't reproduce. So a mule would not be a recognized species. So there you have it. We're divided up from simple to complex, or from large to small. Our biosphere divided into biomes. Biomes contain ecosystems. Ecosystems contain communities. Communities contain populations. And populations contain individual species. So now that we've talked about how scientists divide up all of these things, let's take a look at some of the different terms for the environment. Okay, when we use the term environment, we mean all the conditions or factors that surround any organism. Environmental conditions include biotic and abiotic factors. So let's take a look at the biotic factors first. Biotic factors include any living part of the environment, like the toad you see here. They also include anything that was a part of something living, like the deer antler that this porcupine is chewing on. The porcupine is gnawing on it to keep his teeth from overgrowing. Biotic factors also include anything that was once a part of something living, like the carcass of the water buffalo here. Now, you might say, okay, the antlers are a part of something living too, and they were, but the antlers themselves were not living. It's kind of like your fingernails, okay? But it still is considered biotic because it was a part of something living. So biotic factors are any living part of the environment. So if biotic factors are the living part of the environment, then abiotic factors are the non-living part of the environment. The prefix a means without or not, and as we already know, bio means life. So abiotic means without life. Abiotic factors are the non-living parts of the environment, the physical components of an ecosystem, the soil, okay, like you see here, the fog. They affect the organisms that are living here, okay? The humidity in the air, the availability of water, okay? All those things are abiotic factors. Anything that can affect the organisms that are living there, but that is non-living, is an abiotic factor. While the differences between biotic and abiotic factors may seem to be pretty clear-cut, let's take a second look at them. Many physical factors, or abiotic factors, can be influenced by the activities of the organisms, or the living factors. The muck along the shoreline of a pond or river is more than just tiny little sand and dirt grains. Bacteria and fungi, remember, they're decomposers. They live in the soil and they break down decaying material, returning those nutrients to the soil. So the richness or the quality of the soil, which is an abiotic factor, is dependent on the organisms that are living in it at the time. So the abiotic can be influenced by the biotic. Living organisms can also affect the abiotic factors in other ways. The shoreline of a forest pond can affect the temperature and the amount of sunlight available. If there's a lot of trees, the temperature is lower and the amount of sunlight is less. Consequently, this affects the amount and types of organisms that live there. Pine trees cause soil to be more acidic because their decaying needles contain a lot of acid. So, while the differences may seem to be very clear-cut, the relationship between biotic and abiotic factors is very complex. We're going to be talking about this relationship all year. It really is pretty amazing and awesome. As we study all of these different biotic and abiotic factors and the relationships between them, we need to talk a little bit more about ecological methods and the tools and techniques that scientists use to study the living world. All scientists use the same basic three methods of research. The first one is observation. Observing is simply using your five senses to describe what you see around you. They can be simple descriptions or they can be more complex descriptions of apparent relationships and behaviors that are observed. Okay, you see that here with the ant colony observation. Okay, they described what they're looking at with the ants, and they even drew pictures of it. And we see ant colony, you know, number five shows an ant colony at a dance party. Experiments are used to test hypotheses. Sometimes a biologist might set up an artificial environment to test a hypothesis. Other times, the experiments are conducted in the natural ecosystem itself. This is what we usually think of when we think of science classes, is all this experimenting. Biology really doesn't have a lot of experimenting going on, though. It has a lot of observing and field study, and it also has a lot of modeling. Modeling is used when a biologist is studying ecological phenomena that occur over long periods of time, or they occur over such a large area or such a tiny area that we can't observe them. They usually involve mathematical formulas in some way based on data that's been collected. There are many, many examples of modeling in the scientific community. Watson and Crick, in this picture, built models of the DNA structure, or different models when they were trying to figure out the structure of DNA, so that they could really see the molecule itself and help to understand how the molecule behaved. This helped them to actually figure out how genetic information was stored and why it's so different from person to person. Think of some large-scale phenomena like global warming, plate tectonics, even weather. We use maps, models, and mathematical formulas to help us understand what's happening, why it's happening, and to predict what might happen. Ever watch the weather when a hurricane is in the Gulf or a tropical storm? That's modeling. It's pretty cool, since it really can help save lives. So that's it for section one. Just a little reminder here of why we take notes. Okay? Notes are very useful. Okay? It's a useful record. It helps you in writing. It helps you to understand material because it's practicing. It helps your memory. And it helps you review for exams. So, and remember, anything you write in your notes, you can use on the quiz. So the more you write, the better. Be sure you're familiar with the vocabulary, too, and the concepts that are here, because a quiz will be coming up soon. Okay? So, bring your notes to class, and we will see you in class. Bye, guys.